Welcome to our time of celebration. If you're visiting, please sign our guest book in the hallway. And if you'd like to be on our mailing list, would you please note your address there? Mother's Day holds a special time in my heart because 66 years ago, I was born on Mother's Day. It was the 13th. So I've always had a special place for that. And of course, in typical fashion, my dad was fishing. So, yeah. Always what he did. Please note the announcements in the bulletin. And on June 3rd, we're having a pine perennial sale. And if you've got any plants, pots, any planters, anything of decor for gardening, please bring it and let us raise some money for our children. This is a fundraiser to help send 15 youth to our summer camp. And it's always a highlight coming because I grab a few things that I don't normally have. This morning, as we celebrate our service, we will be celebrating Holy Communion. And everyone is welcome to the table and no one is turned away. So please participate with us in communion. Wherever you are in your journey, you're welcome in this place. Let us pause for a moment, a sign of reflection, before we begin our gathering song. Thank you.
All desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God,
have mercy on us.
We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit so that we may live and serve you in units of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Here is sign of God's love.
Thank you. 5:60. Filled with the Holy Spirit, Stephen gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they covered their ears and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he died. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm chapter 31, verses 1 through 5 and 15 through 16. In you, O Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness.
Incline your ears to me. Make haste to deliver me.
Be my strong rock, a castle to keep me safe, for you are my prop and my stronghold. For the sake of your name, lead me and guide me.
Take me out of the net that they have set for me, for you are my tower of strength.
Into your hands I commend my spirit, for you have redeemed me, O Lord, God of truth.
When my times are in your hand, rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me.
Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. The second reading comes from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 2 through 10. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourself be built into a spiritual house, to be holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious. And whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you, then, who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The words that I say to you, I do not speak. that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if ye do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
If we think back to last Sunday, when Jesus was compared to the good shepherd, this Sunday could be confusing. It certainly seems to be for the disciples. They are hearing that the shepherd they've been following for so long is opening a door that they cannot pass through. They have gone everywhere together, and now they're going to be left behind. But Jesus says, relax, you'll be fine. And the disciples are having a tough time relaxing. Don't let your hearts be troubled, Jesus says. Really? Judas has just left to hand you over to the enemy, and you are convinced that Peter will deny you, and now you tell us you are going to the Father. So why can't we come with you? If you leave, what will happen to us? Who will be the shepherd who leads us and watches over us now? Don't worry. You'll be fine. We'll be fine. How will we be fine? Jesus says, don't worry. Believe in God. Believe also in me. For some reason, this makes me think about all those little kids on the first day of school who get left behind by their parents for the first time. The very first time you leave your baby to the sitter is hard on you. But the first time that child is actually aware that you have gone somewhere and they cannot follow you, this is stunning, especially to them. How many of you couldn't even go into the bathroom and close the door when they were first able to toddle after you? And when you did close the door, that's when they really needed you. Mom, 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 I'll be all right. Just be patient. Relax. Separation anxiety is real. The first time you took them to school, is it harder on you or on them? I'm pretty sure that the disciples are dealing with separation anxiety here. Trust God and trust me, Jesus says. I'll be back. And you'll be fine until the end. You already have all the tools you need. This text is relatively early on in what are often referred to as the farewell discourses. And in response to the disciples' reaction to his news that he is leaving, Jesus makes a promise to his disciples. Though I go away, it is to prepare a place for you in the presence of my Father. I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going. Thomas first says straight out, what do you mean, you know the way to where I am going? We don't know the way. Thomas, of course, looks for a physical way. But Jesus is telling him, the manner of life that I have led is the way you must lead your lives. Philip said, Master, show us the Father, and then we'll be content. So Jesus moves away from talk about going away to again tell them to trust or believe that he and the Father are one. To see and know Jesus is to see and know the Father. And they have seen Jesus' face, heard his voice, and even more importantly, have seen what he has done in his miraculous works. To know Jesus is to know the Father. Come on, Phyllis. You've been with me all this time and you still don't get it? Really? But as is often the case in the book of John, the disciples don't understand what he's saying. It's not an easy thing to deal with metaphorical language and symbolic meanings are difficult for many to grasp. Thomas needs to see to believe, and Philip needs plain language to understand. They miss the symbolism, and mistake his reference to his father's house for a physical geographical space on a map. And so Thomas asks for directions. Show us the way. We don't know the way. Jesus then responds, I am the way and the truth and the life. In other words, Jesus is telling Thomas he already knows the way. But he's not talking about a physical path. And this is what is hard for the disciples to grasp and what Jesus is trying to get across to Thomas. You know me, Thomas. Because you know me, you know the Father. Walk a path similar to the one you have walked with me. You will go down a new path of your own, start on your own journey. But because Thomas knows Jesus, really knows him, he can't get lost. Jesus himself is already. There's no need to panic, no need to search desperately for a secret map. Jesus adds, if you know me, and you do, you will know my Father also. This is the whole of Jesus' mission, to make known the Father, to reveal who God is. Jesus, who has come from the heart, the center, the being of the Father, is now returning there. He is the fullest revelation of the person and character of God. If we want to know who God is, we need to look no further than Jesus. All the words that Jesus has spoken, all the works that he has done, come from God and show us who God is. I'm convinced that this text is not so much about how to get to heaven, but rather it has everything to do with life here. Perhaps these chapters are referred to as the farewell discourses, not because he's saying goodbye, but because it's how he wants his disciples to live. To fare. The definition of fare is to perform in a specified way in a particular situation or over a particular period of time. How will you fare? Not so much a goodbye as it is an admonition of how he wants them to perform in his absence. Fare well. Do the work that I have entrusted to you. After 3 years, Jesus entrusts his mission to his disciples. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact, will do greater works than me. Because I am going to the Father, I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. We can imagine Thomas and Philip and the others with them thinking back over the works Jesus has accomplished. What did they say about Jesus, about the Father? Water to wine? Lazarus to life, a loaf of bread and a couple of fish making a banquet, healing the lame, the blind, the leper. These were the works of God, Father and Son. And now they are to take on Jesus' mission and do even more. How is this possible? Elizabeth Johnson from the Lutheran Institute in Cameroon, says, perhaps our problem is that in hearing these promises, we expect to do these greater works in the same way that Jesus did them, with miraculous power that instantly solves the problem at hand. Even miracles are not guaranteed to produce faith. Many in John's gospel who witnessed the signs that Jesus performs have trouble seeing the work of God right before their eyes. Jesus promises to be with us through the power of the Spirit, to work in and through us to accomplish his purposes in the world. But this does not necessarily happen in easily visible, spectacular ways. Yet wherever there is healing, reconciling, life-giving work happening, this is the work of God. Wherever there is life in abundance, this is Jesus' presence in our midst. Jesus lived, died, was raised again, and ascended to God that we may have life here and forever in abundance. That is his promise. And I want you to remember, you are not alone. Amen. We continue with our
Those who grieve and heal those who are ill, especially Tom Wagner.
Lord, hear mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For this assembly, bless mothers and all who are offering motherly care. Strengthen childcare workers, nursery attendants, and those who teach your youth. Uphold our elders and those who care for aging parents. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
With thanksgiving, we remember those who have died in faith and those who have borne witness to your love. Bring us with them to dwell with you forever. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Joining our voices with your faithful ones in every time and place, we offer our prayers in the name of the risen one, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated for the offering.
Thank you.
again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us all our trespasses, and as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray together. Life and God,
in the mystery of Christ's death and resurrection, you sent light to conquer darkness, water to give new life, and the bread of heaven to nourish your people. Send us forth as witnesses to Jesus' resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world. Through the same Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
I will send you a song.
Thank you.